Welcome to this week's episode of Listen to Your Coaches. I'm your coach, Mike Wilkins, here with Coach Will Morrill. And on the ones and twos behind the scene, we got Max, ever so feral, Gerald. All right, this week we're going to be breaking down this upcoming UFC pay-per-view event, UFC 310. Is that correct? Is that the correct number, Max? UFC 310. All right, where do you want to start? Because it's going to be a good card.
It's going to be a great card. Let's just start right at the top.
Well, let's just start how surprised I was. Right? So we're like talking about like, oh, hey, what are we going to talk about? This and that. And I'm like, oh, yeah, I really want to talk about like, you know, Shavkotny and Garry, Pantoja and Asakura. And then I was like, who's even else is on the card? And then you just banger after banger after banger.
Did even like the early prelims have interesting fights?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Not just, all right, let me rephrase, not just interesting fights, like established stars.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Dude, we got Chris Weidman on the early, early prelims. We've got Aljo on the regular prelims. Like, this is a big card.
Yeah.
With that said, though.
Let's run it
from the top. So, main event, Alexandre Pantoja against Kai Asakura. This is a really interesting fight. So, you and I just watched some film this morning.
Yep.
On both these guys. And should we just...
Here goes something that's incredibly interesting about this title fight. This is Asakura's
first
UFC debut.
UFC. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. And we've seen this a number of times in the flyweight division. I think one of the guys who fought Demetrius was a promotional debut. And the guy who fought Pantoja, I think two times ago, was it Steve Ersig?
Ersig. He was, what, only ranked 10th? It was his third UFC fight or something?
Oh, I thought that was his promotional debut, too. I thought there was another guy recently who did
no.
that. But I think this is the weight class that we're going to see that occur in like the most.
Right now, flyweight's my favorite weight class.
Dude, flyweight's been our favorite weight class for a while.
I mean, on these recent episodes, you know, some of the, just the way that they're blending their striking with their grappling and the pace that's being put on. I mean, that Roy Vall, Tyra fight.
Dude, that was so sick.
That undercard fight with that Carpenter kid.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and other fights in between. Flyweight has just been really putting it on.
Super fun.
And one of the things that we were kind of like taking away from certain flyweights was they weren't showing that well-rounded game on some recent cards, and it's like that's something you absolutely have to have at the flyweight division, right?
100%.
It's like the meta of the flyweight division.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
All right, cool. So in this fight, I am taking Asakura by knockout.
Yeah, I think that's the official LTYC prediction. What we saw when we watched these fights is, you know, Asakura's game is long, bouncy, very explosive, trying to pick his shots really, really perfectly. And when he does connect, he does serious, serious damage, especially with his right hand.
Yeah. There was that x-ray floating around.
Yeah, that's
on
right.
Instagram of he broke a gentleman's jaw.
Yeah.
And like, it was like one of the craziest jaw breaks I've seen. It was a break like, you know, like by the bottom teeth, and then a break up by like, you know, where the jaw connects.
So you get a whole piece of mandible.
Yeah, was dislodged. Which
that's crazy.
Quite incredible coming out of a flyweight.
Right. Yeah. So when you have that style and that kind of power.
Now here goes some questions I have, and Max, maybe you could chime in on this. You notice how I made my Max louder to remind him he's going to need to yell while he does not have a mic. Asakura has only fought bantamweight up until this point, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Now, does Ryzen do like similar to, why is he fighting bantamweight in Ryzen? And why is this a flyweight fight?
You got to shout.
That's a good
get
question.
It all out.
It's a good question. I don't know exactly. I believe they do have a flyweight division in Ryzen. I don't know why he chose to fight bantamweight over there and then come over and fight flyweight. But because I do know that Ryzen has, because Kiyoshi Horiguchi is their flyweight champion right now.
Mm-hmm.
So they do have a flyweight division.
Yeah, maybe they train together or something.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
No, Kiyoshi Horiguchi, they're 1-1 against each other. We watched a video of him.
Oh, that's right. Yeah,
morning.
Yeah, yeah.
Horiguchi actually trains with Pantoja.
Interesting.
Okay. Yeah.
Very interesting. Yeah, so I mean there's a lot of unknowns that could definitely play into it. It's like, hey, has he only been fighting 135 and how's he gonna do at 125?
Right.
Is the weight cutting culture over there just as such from, you know, my experience, from my understanding over history, the weight cutting culture over there, they just don't cut as much weight,
mm-hmm.
right? So maybe he is the same size as a 25er,
right.
But since they're not really cutting as much over there, He's fighting at 35. But yeah, you know, now he's here at flyweight. And as long as that weight cut, you know, goes well and everything goes according to plan, I see a real serious path to victory for him, you know, knockout with the right hand.
Yeah, agreed.
You know, I think it's going to come off of countering the jab. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And like, it's lightning quick. It comes from a little bit of an outside angle. The angle trajectory is like on a down and in. And I could really see that happening, especially in a 5-round fight. I haven't seen anything in his past fights to let me know that, to like lead me to believe he's going to gas out.
Right. Yeah. No, he looks like he can.
And if he's, and like, that's where the weight cut could come into play, though, you know? And if he doesn't gas out, you know,
all he has to do is find
one. I think that right hand's like a real threat. Now, on the odds, he's running at a plus 215, but on FanDuel, by method of knockout, is running at a plus 310. So I'm wavering on where to put my unit if I just want to take just the win, the win, and go to the plus 215, or if I want to take the flyer on the knockout, because I do think that's how it's going
to happen. I was going to say, I think that's his biggest opportunity to win.
So. If you told me this fight went to decision, I'm going to say Pantoja wins.
Yeah.
If you tell me this fight ends by submission, I'm going to say Pantoja wins. Mm-hmm. Right? So like...
Yeah. How can he win? Knockout's the best way. Yeah. Well, getting back to that real quick, we were, you know, discussing kind of the tactics and such, that big right hand. Something else that you and I saw in the film
was... moving backwards.
Well, slow down. We're not even there yet.
I thought that's where you were going.
No. Remember when we watched, he cracked that dude who was standing up?
Yeah, that was Horiguchi.
And when we watched it, okay, yeah, so he
dropped Horiguchi. Horiguchi like slid back to a rear knee.
And then as he stands up.
And then started coming up and he tracked his head like through the levels.
And we saw it at the like the perfect angle slow-mo and he's standing up. And so like he starts the punch as Horiguchi's standing and then the punch lands like, you know, I don't know, 2 feet above where Horiguchi's head was. And he, like you said, he tracked it perfectly. So I think that accuracy is really going to matter for him. And also, something that we noticed is Pantoja doesn't really move his head much.
No.
You know, like, not in the way that you think an elite MMA fighter should be. And
just in some very simple things. Like, when I was, like, you know, noticing Asakura's lightning quick right hand, especially off the counters. So then when I went to go scout Pantoja, I was very much focused on his left hand.
Right.
Right? You know? Mm-hmm. And I was just, like, kind of, like, spending a good deal of time paying attention to, like, how he used it, how he threw it, and mostly where it returned to.
Yep.
And it was not giving me confidence in his, you know, for Pantoja in regards to that. But I am kind of putting all my chips on that one area.
Yeah.
But I think that area, you know, it's definitely going to play.
Something else that I think is important here. So Pantoja doesn't move his head, right? Okay, so, all right. We can break down, like, punch defense in a couple of different ways, but let's make it real simple. You can move your feet, just be gone, not get hit. You can move your head so that your head doesn't get hit, but you're still in the pocket. Or you can use your hands to block and catch, right?
Yeah.
What did we hear his corner say? He was like,
hands up.
He said, get your hands up. Against really good strikers, that's not enough.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you need to be blending those. Kind of what we talked about with Taporia. One of the things that makes him so good is he doesn't rely on the same defense all the time. He's not just pulling. He's not just catching. You know, he's not just moving his feet. He's doing all of them. And, you know, we watched, you know, just for reference, if anyone wants to see what we were watching Pantoja.
Moreno. Like it's the one that we use for most of the, our basis.
And we saw him just walking forward. So he's not moving his feet out of the way, not moving his head in the slightest, and occasionally having his hands up, but just going like this, especially in little gloves, not enough. So I think when you mix all those factors together.
I think the Moreno fight's a good base to like get a judge off of this because Royval, he's southpaw?
Yes.
Yeah. So like, you know, Moreno's, or I would say Royval has probably a little bit like something in similar to length as Asakura, but
that's actually, do we have heights here?
We don't
have Asakura's.
No, because they haven't seen him in person yet.
That's one thing too I was thinking about is Asakura, you know, he uses that, he's like long and skinny and everything, and he uses that range really well.
Right.
Pantoja's like relatively
he's 5'5". I disagree.
Yeah, but I mean, we saw him next to Moreno, and he looked like he had way longer arms than Moreno.
Maybe.
Now, granted,
67-inch reach. That's a 5'7" reach. So, his reach is 2 inches, you know, past the ape index. So.
Yeah, I would say that.
I would say he does have a reach for his height.
He has a reach for sure. for sure. I wonder if that's going to be an issue for Asakura. Probably not.
I'm exhausted on this fight.
Yeah, I think that's good.
So LTYC, coach's pick. We are taking the underdog in the title fight, going at a plus, currently at a plus 215. Yeah, Asakura. All right, let's move us. Now, this is, in my opinion, this is the people's main event right here.
Sure is.
So
sure is.
Go ahead.
So we have Ian Machado Garry against Shavkat Rakhmonov. So first thing we got to talk about, why is his nickname, is it his nickname? Machado. Was he with the Machados?
Yeah, he's married.
Oh, he married in.
Yeah.
Oh, and that's the whole name change thing. Got it. I thought that was his nickname for the longest.
Does he have a nickname? Max, does Ian Garry have a nickname? What is it?
Yeah, his nickname is The Future.
The Future. That's not going to age well.
Pass.
Okay, that makes much more sense.
Does Shavkat have a nickname?
Yeah, The Nomad.
That's
super cool.
that's cool. I like that one.
Another fun thing, I was telling you about this earlier, Mike, that I saw that interview where they're like, Shavkat, what's your favorite animal? And he's like, horse. I'm like, what's your favorite food? And he's like, horse meat. I was like, dude, that guy's a savage.
That is.
Savage. All right, so let's dive into
he's from Uzbekistan? I thought he was Kyrgyzstan.
Oh, no, I thought he was Kazakh.
Or yeah.
Yeah. Everything I've heard is that he's from Kazakhstan.
Wow. We either have just discovered a UFC site issue or we have been lied to.
That wouldn't be the first.
Listen, dude, there's lots of stuff about MMA fighters I don't know.
For example, he definitely is rocking the Kazakh flag, right?
Machado. Dude, I couldn't tell you. I'm American. I don't know geography.
I know the flags based on wrestling.
Because wrestling, that makes sense.
From like the singlets and stuff.
Yeah, and so you would know that like region especially.
It's like that baby blue with the yellow.
Yeah, Wikipedia, ESPN, Sherdog, they all have him listed as a Kazakhstan fighter.
Yeah, so we're going to run Kazakhstan. Yeah, so anyhow, this is a 5-round co-main event. Mm-hmm. So I'm really into this being a 5-round co-main event. And I think that's a little bit telling of what we can think this fight to play out is. So, they're teammates.
Right. Former teammates.
Former teammates.
Yeah.
But, if I'm correct, they were teammates until the fight was signed. And then, Ian Garry left.
He left prior? Yeah.
Yeah, Gary's been bouncing, like, all over the place for the past couple of years.
Yeah, he's just been like a...
He's been training in Shoot the Box, he's training in Thailand right now. He just goes all over the place.
He took Shavkat's nickname and was like, I'm going to run with that.
He did.
Nomading around.
So I heard, you know, I'm sure you've heard as well that Shavkat, you know, was giving it to him in the room, right?
Well, we saw that footage.
Yeah. So what would make Ian Garry want to take this fight?
A couple things. One is improvements he's made since leaving. And two is an understanding, I think this is what you're getting at, an understanding that that was practice and not fighting.
Okay, yeah.
Different things.
So, yes, true, that is different things. I think that I got to think that Ian Garry thinks that he will not be submitted by Shavkat. And I think that he can give him issues with Shavkat taking him down. Mm-hmm. So what I think Ian Garry thinks is that he can knock him out. And I think that's why he wanted a 5-round fight, because he's got five like extra shots to like throw it, right? So like the longer the fight, the more chances he gets to throw that knockout strike, right?
Exactly.
That's my read on it. He's probably been ragdolled by Rakhmonov in practice, you know, but believes that he can, you know, contest takedowns. He probably believes he's going to be put down, but when he gets put down, he probably believes he's not going to be submitted. And you know, with 5 rounds, that's at least at the minimum 5 restarts, and he's got to believe that he's going to be able to get to his feet a handful of times, and he's clearly not concerned about, like, cardio.
Well, also, I mean, so you and I watched just before this, Rakhmonov and Wonderboy, and Wonderboy has fantastic takedown defense, but, you know, Shavkat, until he did take him down, really struggled to take him down. And I wonder also if Garry wonders if, like you said, for the 5-rounder, if he can wear on him a little bit in the clinch and just, like, take out some of his energy, you know, and like you said, you know, get a step ahead in the energy department, which allows him to maybe land that shot. Big thing with this fight, I think that the odds, and also I think just based on, like, what I'm seeing on, like, Instagram, and granted, that's my, you know, algorithm and bubble, so like who knows how accurate this is of the overall like fan base. But I think a lot of people are looking past Garry in this, and I do think that Shavkat wins, but I don't think that like I don't think it's like as big of a disparity as people all right. are making it out to be.
Let me ask you a few questions. Mm-hmm. This co-main event finishes, all right?
Yeah.
And the winner is by knockout. Who won?
Garry.
The winner is by submission.
Shavkat.
The winner is by decision.
Shavkat.
Right. So for those exact reasons, I'm going to take Shavkat in this fight as well, mm-hmm. which is completely ironic compared to the rationale and the pick in the main event.
Right.
It's the exact same fight. It's the exact same fight as the main event.
Kind of is.
The difference is I feel like Asakura has a better shot at landing a knockout. It comes to Pantoja's defense on the feet.
And offense takedown-wise, I think, is really
yeah,
important.
Yeah, well, yeah, that as well. So, yeah, but I'm going to go Shavkat. Max, scroll me down a little bit. Let me see what the odds are running right now. Shavkat, at a minus 380.
That's what I'm saying.
So, one unit, not going to bring you back the best return, but money is money. And, I mean, geez, I mean, if you just think about that, what, if you're running at a minus 380, let's say you put a unit on it, you're getting, you know, you're getting like a 22% return on investment there.
But here's the thing. I don't think that those odds reflect the actual percentages, you know, in terms of, like, who would win, you know, if they fought 100 fights, like, how many times they would win, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So if someone was looking for an underdog pick, I don't think Garry's a bad choice necessarily.
Oh, yeah, I agree. Yeah. I agree. Okay, cool.
But these are Mike's picks, so, you know.
Yeah, these are my picks. I'm going a unit on Asakura. I'm at least going a unit on him, and I might slide that unit to by KO.
Dude, in our reviews, we should start doing sections where we go over your bets and, like, how they
Yeah, how maybe we even put graphics up.
Did graphics up, and maybe we should keep a spreadsheet. I know you're a big fan of spreadsheets.
You know, at some point in time, we have to stop.
We have to stop what?
We'll have to stop betting. A point in time will come where I'm not going to be, I don't think we're going to be allowed.
Yeah, yeah. So we got to get it in while we can.
Yeah.
Although, dude, I just heard, I can't remember who it was. I just heard someone talking about, like, betting on fights. I want to say it was, like, coaches or something, like, publicly, like, in, like, podcasts or something.
Well, I think we're allowed to, like, give, like, what we would do.
No. Someone talked about, like, actually betting. You know, I think it was Rockhold.
Well, Rockhold's retired.
Oh, yeah, he is.
Yeah. All right. So, anyhow, move us on. What do we have next? Oh, we got the big boys, Cyril Gane and Alexandre Volkov.
So, this fight is interesting because Volkov, while slow, is, like, legitimately skilled. And Gane, standing, is very, very skilled. But I do think that if Gane gets cracked once or twice, I think he shoots.
Yeah?
Yeah, I do.
How does that end up?
I think he's a better grappler than Volkov. But, like, after seeing what John Jones did to him, it's like, how much? You know what I mean?
Right.
I don't know. Cyril Gane's an interesting one because, like, I just feel like if he trained, like, exclusively wrestling with, like, a pinch of jiu-jitsu for, like, a year straight, then he's, like, you know, he's the poor man's Aspinall, you know? But I think that he just has, like, a serious ground deficit. Or Jones is just, you know, Jones, which makes sense, too. But I don't know. I don't think his ground game is very good. Although, I was just telling you earlier, and Max, maybe you'll know this, didn't he finish a fight in the UFC with a heel hook?
Yes, he did.
Okay, so he did do that.
It was like his second or third fight in the UFC, but he did. He does have submission offense.
Right. So, you know, that's against another heavyweight. So take that for what you will. But with that said, I do think that Gane's a better striker than Volkov, and I think his speed allows him to win there, and I only think he shoots if he's losing the stand-up. So, I think we see Cyril Gane with either a, you know, KO victory or a decision victory. I don't really see Volkov winning this. What are the odds on this?
Yep, the odds reflect Cyril Gane coming in at a minus 325. I will be abstaining from betting on this fight. But
I think
Will's going to put one unit on it, which is his mortgage.
I think these odds are about right, actually. But, yeah, that's about all I have to say on this fight. You got any insight on...
Nothing.
What are your thoughts on Volkov's grappling?
I don't even know who he is.
You never seen Volkov fight?
No.
Oh, that he's so tall and he's really slow, but he's like good. So he makes good like striking decisions, but he's too slow to like do them at the level to beat like, you know, the Aspinalls or the, you know, John Joneses. But he beats a lot of guys who, and he's like exactly where he should be. He's probably like ranked number five or something. And he's 6'7" in Russian. So he's just, it's rocky every time he fights. It's pretty sick.
Okay.
But on to the next one.
Oh, yeah. I like this fight. We've got Bryce Mitchell versus Kron Gracie. Man, main card. They main carded this?
So this is the fight that took over for Aljo. This is the one that bumped Aljo.
I would have flopped those.
I agree. I think that's the Aljo fight is way higher skill level. I don't know. I don't have a lot to say about this other than I think the odds are very, very accurate. I think Bryce Mitchell, like, again, it's not a jiu-jitsu match. And I think that his...
Okay, I've got questions.
Okay.
Max, feel free to chime in on these. Where has Kron been training for this fight?
That's a good question.
Was there anything about him on the countdown?
There was no mention of him on the countdown.
Okay.
You got scream.
The countdown ended after Volkov and Gane.
Right, yeah, right? Typically it's those three.
There's no mention of him on the countdown. As far as I know, he's been training out and...
Still in Montana? Hmm. All right, I'm going Bryce Mitchell running away with it. If Kron, like, you know, was like, hey, I'm going to go spend a couple months back with, you know, the people I was training with when I was first in the UFC, like when he was with the Diazes, and their coaching staff, then I would have listened to something. But, I mean, Kron's last performance was just absolutely atrocious. It was a cuttable performance.
I've got two questions. One, do you think that Mitchell's chin has been affected by Josh Emmett? And two, let's start there.
Was that Bryce Mitchell's last fight, the Josh Emmett knockout?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it was affected by it.
But now, do you think enough time went on for him to like build it back enough? And do you think he was smart enough in training not to get cracked too much?
I do.
Okay.
I do think he was smart enough in training. Has it been long enough? I mean, that's, I don't think there's like a,
I think for a way for us like to know. So,
it was violent.
Let's look at some examples of it, right? So, Manny Pacquiao, you remember when he got slept bad by, was that Marquez?
No, I don't remember.
Max Dino? It doesn't really matter, but...
someone called Jonas.
This might have been when I was in college now that I'm thinking about it. This is a while back, but he got slept badly. You know the one I'm talking about where he fell forward?
It was Marquez.
It was Marquez, and it was like their fourth fight or something, but... In that, after that fight, Freddie Roach made him take a year off before his next fight.
Yeah, I recall.
And that, I think, is about the right timeline for a bad knockout like what Bryce had against Emmett. I think you should take a full year off. Now, obviously, there's degrees of like knockouts and such. Also, when do we know when that fight was?
Bryce Mitchell and Josh Emmett?
Yeah.
That was December of last year.
Full year.
Okay, so you got a full year. Okay, so as long as he hasn't been just like throwing down and sparring and like ruining his chin... I don't think that's going to be a huge issue. Next question, and this is only based off of the picture we have up right now. How old is Kron?
34.
Okay.
I don't know. That was a guess.
But I mean, look at that picture, dude. Like, doesn't he look like he could be, you know, anywhere from 34 to 47?
Yeah.
Maybe it's just a bad picture. I don't know.
Well, anyhow, I'm taking Bryce Mitchell in this fight. I'm actually excited to see it, that almost because of Kron's last performance being so terrible, like to see. And here goes the thing about Kron's performance being so terrible. It was like such a stark contrast from his previous performances. Mm. Now, he had been off for many years. Mm. He had not fought for many years. Can we go to Kron's record? Did he fight Brian Ortega?
No.
Who did he fight that was good?
He fought Cub Swanson.
Okay, that's it. What year was that?
Wait, he beat... Oh, no. Jourdain beat him. Okay, that makes sense. Jourdain's good.
He's been very inactive.
Jourdain's real good.
What year was the Swanson fight? I can't see that far.
2019.
Yeah, so 2019, right? And then that Jourdain fight was
23.
I was there live for that.
Oh, really? Where was it?
In Newark, New Jersey.
Oh, wow.
That's sick.
Look at you, traveling to go watch UFC fights.
Didn't Jourdain just switch weight classes?
Yeah, he dropped down to 35.
Bantamweight, that's right. Yeah, that guy's good. Dude, have you seen him fight before?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm yeah, he's a beast. Yeah, dude, I think Kron gets smashed. That's really all I got to say.
Yeah. Okay, cool. All right, let's move on. Next fight.
Battle of the Flatter.
Because it's a minus...
750.
A minus 750? That can't be right. Was that right?
That was for...
Oh, is this main card?
Yeah, that's main card, but the 750, that was for Bryce.
Whoa, I saw it at a minus 520 earlier.
You know what we're going to have to call that fight?
Click on him again. Click on that fight, and then go to the odds.
This is the Bryce Mitchell fight.
Yeah, to the right. Minus 520. See? Minus 520 there.
Oh, yeah, it's different even on the same, on the UFC.
Wow. Site. Okay, listen, we can't take the UFC site. Seriously. Yeah, they need to get literally on the same exact page, scroll down just a smidge. It says 520, minus 520, and minus 750 on the exact same page.
That's wild.
All right, Nate Landwher versus...
Hold on. That fight is going to be officially dubbed the Lucas Siebert fight.
Oh, yeah. Team Flat Earth.
Team Flat Earth. We're all starting that rumor back up.
All right.
All right, on to the next one.
This fight is the fight I am most looking forward to in relation to other people.
You know, I didn't know until you brought it up on the last podcast that was Landwher at the... where was that?
Williamsport?
In Williamsport, yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah, until you brought that up, I had no clue that was him.
Yeah, that was him.
Dude, best speech of all time.
Yeah, he's hilarious, and he's also just like a dog. He's an absolute dog. He's a workhorse. Mm-hmm. He just grinds and grinds and grinds. He's going to be a tough out for anybody. He's got great cardio. Now, Choi, what do you got for me?
He's from South Korea.
Yeah, do you like him? Is that what would they call him, like Superboy or something? What do they call, what's his name?
The Korean Superboy.
Yeah, Korean Superboy.
So automatically, if someone's South Korean, I like them because one of my best friends from childhood is South Korean. So, you know,
BK,
represent for the homie.
Yeah, I'm going Nate Landwher in this fight. Why? Just because I think he's gritty and he's gonna persevere through maybe some difficult exchanges, and he's gonna be there at the end of the fight. It's gonna be a dirty fight,
and we know he's been
putting
in that
work. It's gonna be a down dirty fight.
We know he's doing them push-ups, kicks,
doing push-ups, sit-ups, throwing all them punches, all them kicks.
Yeah, I think absolutely. We gotta go with Nate. That's the official LTYC.
LTYC pick, Nate.
Love it. All right, that's the last
junkyard
name,
dog.
Right?
Yeah. What?
Yeah. Yeah.
What?
I know,
dude. Whoa, let's talk prelims now. You guys can watch these live and free on ESPN. The main card, you're gonna have to buy that pay-per-view or find that
Russian link.
Russian link.
Pull a Khabib.
So we've got Dominic Reyes versus Anthony Smith, two former title contenders.
So this is interesting because these are guys who, like you said, were at the top of the, you know, division at one point. With that said, I think that they are past their peak. I don't think that anyone, you know, would disagree with me probably on saying that. And to be perfectly honest with you, I think they've had a very quick decline. So Dominic Reyes, highlight of his career, is, you know, nearly beating John Jones, right? In a very close fight that, honestly, anyone who fights John Jones should be proud of. And then since then, he's been, what, knocked out at least once badly? And...
three times.
There we go. That's what I was looking for. Thanks, Max.
By at least one. Hey, at least once, but no more than four.
Hey, no more than four.
Wait, is that within our standard deviation?
So he's been on a big slide. Anthony Smith, I don't think he's been like KO'd badly, but I saw one of his last couple of fights and it didn't look great from what I remember. So, you know, this is two guys who are kind of on the decline, but both have serious skills.
This is Anthony Smith.
Also, one thing real quick, I think we should shout this out about
59th fight.
Anthony Smith.
He was CFFC champ.
Probably like 20 years ago or something.
No, when I was joking.
Damn,
dog. That hurt my feelings.
I didn't mean to hurt your feelings. But one thing I think we should shout out Anthony Smith for, because a lot of like newer fans might not know this, but when he did fight for the title, he got hit with an illegal blow,
and he could have been the champ.
He could have just said like, "Nah, I'm hurt too bad.
I can't continue," and he would have got the belt off of a DQ.
Yep. And instead,
he was like, "No."
He was like, "No." And he just like kept going. And that's one of those things that like everyone's like, oh yeah, like of course that's the right thing to do. And yet, like, there's a lot of kids who are like weren't around at that time who like have no idea about it.
Right.
And you know, I mean, it's just gonna be forgotten in the history of MMA at some point. You know, it just is what it is. But I think it's worth shouting out. I think that's a really cool thing that Anthony Smith did.
Yeah.
That has, you know, always kind of made me.
Yeah, I think it's important to say that.
Yeah.
To bring
exactly.
it back to light.
Like that's a highlight of his career in my mind. You know what I mean? He didn't almost beat John in the same way that Dominic Reyes did, but he did something fantastic in that fight that like really shows he's a true fighter, you know
yeah.
what I mean? So
because you think about what would happen if he would have took that, right? So then he gets pay-per-view points.
Yep.
He's gonna rematch John Jones.
Endorsements just from being the champ.
Yeah, just from being the champ.
You can never take away those pictures of him holding the belt, you know what I mean?
Like, yeah, and it's another title fight.
Exactly.
Like,
yeah.
You know what I mean?
It's at least one more title fight for sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, that was like very very cool of him to do that. But anyways, yeah, this fight, to be honest with you, I think we're going to see two guys who are aging out of their place in the top of the sport, but still have hopefully something to offer in an entertaining fight.
Yeah.
That's kind of the best I can hope for this.
Give me the odds, Max. All right. So the odds are allegedly Dominic Reyes coming in at a minus 340, Anthony Smith at a plus 270.
I don't know.
What if I told you that I would take Anthony Smith by submission?
I think that's a great.
Here goes what I'm going to do. I'm not going to put a full unit on that, but I'll put something on that.
Dude,
put a
honestly,
quarter unit.
Well, no. I mean, actually,
some fun money. Put a quarter unit on
How does Lionheart win? Because submission I like.
Submission.
But it's probably because he hurt him a little first. And Dominic Reyes is very chinny at this point in his career.
Yeah.
So it is possible that he could KO him as well. So if I were you, I would look up what the odds were on submission. If they're way higher, I would go for that. Otherwise, as a dog, I don't hate that.
Yeah.
With that said, I think Reyes is a little faster still, and as long as his offense gets going, he wins. But
you know what I might do? I might post my bets once I place them.
That's not a bad idea. People can follow along. But here's the thing. If we post your bets, we also have to post the results.
What do you mean?
Like, after it all, you know, goes through, just screenshot like what the results are, and then we post those too.
Well, yeah, but I want to pre-fight post my bets.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
That way it doesn't look shady.
Right, definitely.
All right, run us down. Man, Vicente Luque, I thought he was rumored to be who did he fight last?
He was supposed to fight Diaz, I believe.
That's it. Right? That's it. Never mind. You don't need to look it up.
Yeah.
Yeah. So tell me about this Femba.
Hold on. Wait. Can we stick on that for a second? Did we figure out what was up with Diaz in that video? Was he just like tweaking?
Dude, I don't know.
Like, to me, it just looked like he was like, you know.
Out of respect for the Diaz family, I refuse to.
Well, I'm going to say something that I think he would be totally okay with. He looked like he was just really high and just, like, playing on the sidewalk. You know, like...
I don't think he wanted to be there.
Yeah,
I don't think
that.
He's, like, super pumped about it.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I'm glad he pulled out then because I did not want to see the Diaz that showed up to fight Robbie. Another super cool thing that a fighter did. Do you remember after that Robbie fight? He was like, dude, are you all right? And he's like, yeah, I'm good. He's like, no. Like, not in fighting, like in life. Are you all right? And like, I think he meant it.
Yeah, I think so too.
I've always liked Robbie Lawler.
Good guy.
Although, Robbie Lawler, one of the few people I've ever been like really intimidated by in person.
Oh, we rode the elevator with him.
We went down and it was all of us. And then I had to go back up to the hotel room and it was just me and him in the elevator. And he was standing in the back and I walked in and there was like a part of me that wanted to be like, oh, there's Robbie Lawler. I want to be like, oh, dude, like, I really like watching you fight or something. And I walked in, he just like stared at me. Like, he wasn't like trying to be mean, just like his like natural face.
Yeah, face.
And I looked in his eyes and all the way to the edge, like of the, you know, the circle part, it was just pure black.
Yeah.
And, like, it looked kind of like a shark. And I looked at him. I just got like kind of scared for a minute. I turned around and didn't say anything. But anyways, neither here nor there. Vicente Luque. Real quick, or Max, you probably know this. What was his last fight?
His last fight was Buckley.
Mm.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Interesting.
Interesting.
How old is Luque?
Luque is, I can just tell you right here.
30.
He's 33.
Oh, he's younger than I expected.
Really? Older than I thought. Tell me about Femba. Well, do you got any insight on him?
I
don't even know.
Fight.
I've never seen him before. Max, your time to shine.
So, Femba is also 33. He's from Zimbabwe.
He got
real famous. He got a lot of popularity around him because a couple months back, he made a video. he made a video about the fact that he was poor and broke and he didn't
this
have
kid
a house.
And The Rock.
The Rock bought him a house.
The Rock, Dwayne The Rock Johnson?
Dwayne Johnson bought him a house. It was this big thing on Instagram.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
He was fighting in the UFC, like, sleeping on a couch.
Yeah.
And he was, like, super thankful for it, too. He made this video, like, dude, look how great my setup is. I'm so thankful to be here in the States. And then The Rock saw it and was like, I think we could do a little better than this. So, cool of The Rock to do that. I have seen him fight.
Very
then.
Cool.
He's a good striker. Long.
You know what? I just don't know enough about him to make... to make a pick on this, and I have been flying by the seat of my pants on a lot of picks, but I'm trying to do well. I want to do well now, so I'm going to abstain.
Okay, so this is an uninformed opinion because I have not seen enough, to be honest, of either of them fighting.
I'll tell you what, our picks are going to get a lot better.
Oh, yeah.
Because now we're paying attention to fights.
Yeah, you... For those watching,
I've just been ripping.
Mike hasn't watched... fight, other than, like, this year, you haven't watched fights, like, regularly in, what, like, 5 years?
Dude, pre-COVID,
yeah.
I was like, I'm out.
Done with
this. I'm out. Don't
so,
like it. Shut up. Watch wrestling.
From what I remember, Themba's striking is very, very explosive and really long, but it's a little bit, it's not quite polished yet. And Luque's striking is very polished, and he hits hard, dude. I'm going to have to go with Luque. I don't know. I'm gonna say
any
Luque,
word on Themba's grappling, because Luque is nice with the darts.
I have never seen him on the ground.
Max, Themba, tell me what you know.
Themba is actually a wrestler. Like, a lot of his striking is, it's like you said, it's not polished.
Mm-hmm.
It's very explosive, very long and powerful, but much of it is to set up his grappling. He's a very good grappler. At least two of his last three fights, he won just out-grappling the dude for 15 minutes. So he's got...
Boring! Move on. He's the favorite. Oh,
dude, this is an interesting fight, actually. I'm kind of excited for this one.
Yeah.
Because literally anything could happen in that.
Oh, now, but hey, let's get off that fight. That fight's lame. All right, let's go to the heroes of the prelims. This should be on the main card.
Dude, it really should.
Versus Aljo. I am so excited. Here goes why everybody should be excited about this fight. This has serious featherweight implications,
mm-hmm.
right? Title picture implications, you know? Now, does the winner get the next title shot? Maybe. Maybe not. But it definitely has domino effects within the featherweight rankings and what we see going on there, right? So, is it confirmed? What's my man's name? The champ. A former champ.
Oh, yeah.
Alex.
Wait.
What's his last name?
Volkanovski.
Is it confirmed? Volkanovski versus Lopez in Australia in February?
I don't think it's confirmed, yeah.
No. Is it rumored still, or was that just like...
I heard rumors, but then I also heard Volkanovski be like, I'm not fighting him next, I'm fighting Ilya.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah, because when I saw that, like, the graph... You know how, the like, some accounts will just post the graphic, mm-hmm. and, like, dude, it looks like it's a UFC announcement.
Exactly.
Yeah. I think I've sent them to you. I'm like, oh, look at this. Or no, I sent it to all of us?
You sent it to me before for sure.
But I think I sent it to Max, too, and Max was like, oh, yeah. No, I sent it in a group. It was all of us in a group. Yeah, and I was like,
it's
announced. And then Max was like, that's not really the UFC. That's just some guy.
That's right.
And I was like, well, it says UFC right on the picture.
Oh, that's right. And then I pointed out, it was like something about like being rumored.
Like after Max was like, that's not the UFC. Like then I looked at it and I was like, oh, it's not. Like I looked at it. I was like, oh, it's the UFC. Like it looked like,
oh, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Because they use the same background.
Yeah, yeah. I didn't look at the username. So yeah.
We should do that sometime. It's just like.
It's like, Grandpa, that's. That's called the internet.
We should just like put up random fights sometimes. Just be like, yo, this one's going to be a banger.
Yeah.
Just fights that aren't going to happen.
What if we did this for like a segment? We had Max get like real like down and dirty and find like some like really unknown information, right? And mm-hmm. he got us two fights that he, through his sources, found out are happening,
uh-huh.
right? And we posted, no, or he only needs to find one.
Okay.
Right, and it's like okay, like some like something like you know like nobody knows,
oh,
but Max through his
going.
Like little
insight, yep.
And then we post three fights, right, and we're like two, it's like two truths and a lie,
yeah,
and like two not really fights, like one that's really happening,
right.
Type of thing.
So then when that one comes out, people are like, yo, these dudes know what they're talking about.
Well, no, I was just saying, like, and then like people could like vote on which one's real.
Oh, like we're just
or,
transparent
like,
about
yeah,
it.
Be like, oh, yeah, be like, yeah, two of these fights aren't. like actually, but one of these, like you've heard of none of these three.
Yeah.
But one of these is actually happening. Whatever. All right. So, I mean, I'm just super interested in this. I mean, I'm really excited to watch Evalev against Aljo. I like how the grappling is going to match up in it. And I think it's really going to paint a picture as far as the featherweight title is concerned. So I think, like, as far as, like, storyline goes with a division developing, I think this fight is huge.
And Aljo looking...
Why is it on the prelims? Is it a slight to Aljo?
I believe so. If I
is it a diss to Aljo, or is it to try to sell the pay-per-view?
No, I think it's a diss to Aljo, 100%. Because I don't think the UFC really loves him. Which is crazy, dude. You get these guys who are in positions where, like, they're good champions. They've defended the title. And they've, you know, maybe been in fights that, like, some people view as boring. But, like, it's just, it's hard to...
And he took the Sean O'Malley fight. He took the Sean O'Malley fight, like, as a favor.
Exactly.
Right? Like, they were, like, and they, like, it was, like, out there.
And also, like...
Like, okay. There's video of it, of, like, Dana and Hunter.
Right. Like, being like, come on, dude.
Yeah.
So, but the other thing is like, okay, if you look at any of the great champions, they're going to have a string of a couple fights that are lackluster in whatever way you want them to call them lackluster. They don't get finishes. They looked human at certain points, whatever. Dude, he's the only guy, at least in modern history, I believe, who's defended the bantamweight title, three times, I think?
Who did he defend against?
He defended against Jan. Then against Henry?
Dillashaw
next?
Dillashaw.
Then Henry. So three defenses against like good dudes.
Bro, that is crazy.
Yeah.
I didn't even know he fought Dillashaw.
Oh, yeah.
It was like a half fight. Dillashaw went into it with his arm completely out of its socket.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I'm like, dude, like, I cannot believe that fight's not like forefront of my mind.
Speaking of Dillashaw, and I don't know why this popped in my head, but we got both of you guys here. I'm assuming you didn't see it, but did you guys think that Sandhagen got robbed against Dillashaw?
No.
Maybe not robbed.
No, I watched that fight. I didn't think so.
I thought he won.
I thought Sandhagen won.
Yeah, I thought Sandhagen won.
Should we do a rewatch and a rescore?
Maybe we should.
As that'd a segment? As a segment?
Yeah.
Not a bad idea.
We can practice. You know what we should do? We can practice our fight companion like that. So what we want to do is we want to do a fight companion, right? So we want to like watch like a pay-per-view, right? And like go live during it so that you guys can like watch it with us. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with fight companions. Rogan does them. Some other people do them as well. But we got to practice like the technical side of it.
Right.
So like a way we can practice it before like going like after the real one, like after going like doing it like a pay-per-view or whatever, is we could just like we could go live while watching back a fight, and that could let us like that way if like the technical difficulties arrive, it's like, yeah, who cares?
Yeah, it's like whatever. You know? It's a fight that happened a year ago.
Yeah. So maybe that's a good idea.
I think that's a great idea.
All right, let's stay on. That's cool. Everybody's really excited about that.
Hold on. Getting back to that, I think they're treating him the way that they treated Woodley. You know what I mean? Like, Woodley was a really good 170 champion.
He was a really good
multiple
champion.
Times.
Yeah.
I don't know if... I think maybe Kamaru did more than him, right?
Kamaru probably did.
Either way, he's a really good champion, and the UFC did not really like him. At least, I mean, I'm saying this based on, like, how they marketed him. I think that they put Aljo in the same kind of... boat, you know, where they're like, all right, the dude's good, but like, we don't really like him that much. And for whatever reason, the fan base doesn't like Aljo. I don't know if it's just because he's like, you know, extended Henzo team guy, but like, I like Aljo. What were your thoughts?
I was just listening to the woodpecker. Yeah, no. I thought it was like Max like banging on the stool.
They're doing construction next door.
Yeah, no. Yeah, I mean, I like Aljo. Like you said, he's an extended teammate. He represents wrestling, so I like that as well.
And personally, he just like
I'm just really
like
interested
cool
in
dude.
This fight, and it's just going to paint a good picture. Everybody should be pretty fired up about it, because right after this fight is over, there's going to be a lot of like questions answered and more questions posed.
Oh yeah.
For those of you who like to follow the sport, especially close to title pictures, this is the fight that you want to see. Who are you taking?
Oh, man. I don't know. I'll take Aljo.
I'm going to take Evalev.
All right.
Max, celebrity shot. Who are you taking?
I think the plus money on Aljo is actually pretty good.
Plus money on Aljo? Guess what?
I like plus money on Aljo, yeah.
Doesn't matter what you think. You're too young to bet, so you're burnt. You're burnt, kid.
All right, on to the next one.
Four more months.
Ooh, Randy Brown.
Four more months, then you can let your money talk. How about that?
Wait, you really can't bet until you're
21. You have to be correct? Am I legally?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes.
So of course he's not betting. I don't know, dude. We're just, you and I are so far removed from that. It's hard to remember. All right, Randy Brown, Brian Battle. I've nothing to say about this other than it's going to be a fun fight.
Yeah, I can't wait to watch this fight. Dude, how about Brian Battle debuting in MMA as a heavyweight?
I know, that's what I was about to say.
Like, looking fat.
And I truly believe there's something to, if you spent some time, like, not just like, oh, for, you know, a 6 month period, I gained some weight and then I dropped it off.
No, you were a heavyweight for some time.
And you were
time.
Athletic at that weight. If you then go down, you carry insane power.
Yeah, dude, like, you keep it. And I think, like, you're like you're more durable.
Yeah, and like your bones are denser.
Like Dempsey's a great example. Yes. Dempsey was a heavyweight, right? Yes. And then he was a middleweight, right? And now he like floats between like, probably like 205, 210 is probably his walking around weight whenever he's like active or whatever. And he's like still got like the strength and like he's just so like durable.
Dude, there's, I mean, it's partially,
and I think it's from
him
carrying around all that weight athletically and wrestling that weight and moving that weight year after year.
I think that plays a big role, but also there's something in his DNA. That dude's different.
Yeah, that too, but I mean, it definitely plays a role.
All right, early prelims. This is nuts. Chris Weidman and Eric Anders. Real quick, Max, click on Eric Anders. Has he won a fight recently?
When's the last fight?
Oh, really?
Oh, in your face. Pickett.
Is that Jamie Pickett?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Dude, he's 2-1 in his last three.
No, he's 3-0.
No, he lost two.
Oh, I see. He lost. I see. Okay.
He beat Dawkus.
Okay. No, this is perfect. This is what I thought then. This is perfect
for
Weidman.
He was on a two-fight skid before then.
So, Eric Anders, if you guys haven't seen him fight Khalil Roundtree, that is a banger of a fight.
Yeah, it is.
That was when Khalil, like, first showed off his, like, newfound Muay Thai skills, you know, along with his, like, super aggressive style. Do you remember in that fight, Anders was grounded, goes to stand up, and, like, his hands like a old rules hands like a millimeter off the floor.
Yeah,
he gets head kicked bad, dude. That was so sick. But anyways, Anders, ex football player, very athletic, good fighter. I don't think he's like, you know, a championship level fighter. To be honest, I don't think he's ever really gonna be.
I think this is probably his retirement fight.
Anders?
Yeah.
Really?
I think I might have read that somewhere.
No. Oh. Well, I think that he's a good matchup for Weidman. So Weidman is, you know, obviously old for, you know, for a fighter, and has had some serious injuries and everything. But Weidman has obviously championship level skills.
Yeah, obviously.
So I think we're seeing a guy
undefeated against Anderson Silva,
who is we have a guy who's like really athletic and good against a guy who is, you know, a little bit older and really good. I think that's about right. I'm really hoping for a Weidman win. Just because that would be incredible for him. And then hopefully he just hangs it up after that. But yeah, that's kind of a wild fight to be.
So this fight was supposed to be on a card earlier.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it got canceled like the day of the fight. Like, I think they made weight.
Oh, that's
and then the
right.
next day, Eric Anders had to pull out with illness.
Mm, okay.
All right. I mean,
I like this fight. Should we go down a little bit more? I think there's actually.
No, that's
the last one. Okay.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's one more fight, Joshua Van versus Cody Durden, but like, we're going. Oh, it's a flyweight fight. We're in.
I don't have anything to say about it.
I mean, I'll watch it.
Pay attention to Joshua Van.
I should pay attention to Joshua Van.
Yeah.
But he's fighting a ranked guy, so he's going to lose to Durden.
11-2. Ooh, he's Burmese.
Interesting.
He's 22 years old.
Oh, he's 22.
Oh,
so she's
11-2 at 22. Yeah. Wow.
Oh my gosh.
Okay. Well, there you go.
All right, I'll be paying attention.
That's a fight to watch.
All right. Cool. All right. So here, I just want you to run me from the top down, or just run me back up.
And we'll give our official picks.
Okay. Yeah. Let's do picks for each fight. All three of us are going to make a pick. All right. Flyweight bout number one. These are not my gambling picks. These are just. Because we have to pick.
Right, these
fight.
Are the LTYC picks.
Yeah, LTYC okay. picks.
Real quick, there are three more fights below this on the card.
Can't do it, dude. I can't do anymore.
They're fine.
Yeah, I can't do anymore. So we're starting with the Joshua Van Cody Durden fight. Should we pick that fight or should we just move up? Should we just do prelims and main card?
Dude, I just love how much you get really into MMA and then, like, within a couple minutes, you're just like, No. Don't care. Mid podcast about MMA, you're like, no, I don't got it in me, bro.
I can't do it anymore. I can't.
Okay, let's give our picks.
No. Let's do just the prelims, not the early prelims, because that's too many.
Okay.
All right, here we go. Starting at the prelim opening, Randy Brown Brian battle. We'll go serpentine draft, right, Max? That's what you like to call it, serpentine draft. Max, you go first.
I'm going to go with Brian Battle by decision.
I'm going to take Randy Brown by knockout. Battle doesn't move his head enough.
All right. I'm going to go Brian Battle.
Okay. So the official.
But I'm not picking how.
So the official LTY decision then is Battle.
No. We'll each have our own. Oh, okay. And we'll keep score.
I thought we were trying to, you know, be a team.
No. We're going to keep score. And this is just.
Oh, okay.
This is the preseason. So here goes what you guys don't know, aren't aware of. We're in the preseason right now because there's only two cards left this year. This one and the next one, right? The Tampa card. This is us practice. This is practice for us. It's preseason. But then starting in January, we're going to make picks for every UFC card through the whole year. And whoever is right at the end wins.
Are you going to make a spreadsheet?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so it's official.
And it'll be like a running thing.
All right.
Right? We'll pick everything. So like at the end of the year, there'll be like, what, like 250 UFC fights? Like, it would be like, oh, Max was, you know, like 14 and 237.
Yeah.
Mike was 252-0.
All right. Okay. I like it. Okay. Right, so
let's practice.
All right. So I got Randy Brown. You two took Battle. Next one, I'm taking Avalev. Aljo.
Just say it. Next.
Yeah. I'm taking Aljo.
All right.
He's cool. Also team Aljo.
Max, also a thing that's going to be your job is to go back and write down our picks.
I was going to say, I'm going to go back and try everything down.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right, so next up, I'm taking Luque. Who you got?
I'm going to go Luque.
I'm going to go Garimbo.
Okay. Yeah. I'm going Reyes.
Yeah, I am also going Reyes.
Reyes. Yeah.
Okay. All right, now we're on to the main card. I'm taking Landwher.
Sorry, Brian. I'm taking Landwher.
I'm going to take Landwher. Yeah.
Okay, nice. Bryce Mitchell.
Yeah, for sure, Bryce. Yeah.
Right. Cyril Gane.
Agreed.
Gane.
All right.
Shavkov.
Also taking Shavkov.
I'm taking Shavkov, too.
All right. Asakura.
You got it. I am also taking Asakura.
I'm going to go Asakura, too.
Please, now we have LTYC picks, the main card. The main card we all agreed on. Boom. So we do have LTYC picks.
Love it.
Let's get a graphic up of our main card picks. All right, cool. All right, that's UFC 310.
We got one more thing to talk about.
On UFC 310?
No. I just meant in general.
Yeah, in general. All right, cool. So, but prior to UFC 310, we have the UFC Fight Pass Invitational 9 going down Thursday night on UFC Fight Pass. If you are unaware of what the UFC Fight Pass Invitational is, it's the UFC's version of a grappling card, right? So it's similar to a fight night, but it's just, you know, their jiu-jitsu events. This is their ninth iteration, and they have all been quite a success so far. Getting some of the biggest names in the grappling world to compete. I hear they're paying pretty well, and that's why. They've also been open to suggestion, so to speak. UFC Fight Pass 1, Invitational 1 through 8, took place on a stage. Mm-hmm. The rule set has also changed throughout. Like, so they're really trying nail this down, right? So they're not like, oh, this is what we did first, and it's what we're always going to do. The rules have changed, the point scoring have changed, and now they have taken it off the stage. Mm-hmm. The stage has not proven to be like a great surface for this. It kind of limits the space, right? Mm-hmm. It does the opposite. Like when we talk about like the CJI and them competing in the alley with 45 degree walls, and we're like, oh, kind of like almost like makes it feel like more open, right? It takes away the middle of the mat being on a stage because you're going to fall off the edge of the stage.
Yep.
And that stops the action as opposed to keeping the action going. So they moved it down to the floor, which I like better, and it turned out a little bit better for UFC Fight Pass Invitational 8. Yeah, 1 through 7 was on the stage. 8 was on the floor.
Okay.
Why should we be taking more interest in this?
Dude, they got Nolf on this?
Dude, yeah, that's why we're talking about it. But why should we? Well, that's one of the main reasons why we're talking about it, and that's going to be an incredibly... That match is the match of the card, all right? We're going to get to it.
It's Canuto. All right.
Yeah, who is Canuto, like... Dive it like flying submissions.
He just did CJI, right? Who am I thinking? I'm thinking the guy who slaps. Who's that?
Oh, that's Varela.
Varela. No, who's Canuto?
Canuto, he went against PJ Barch. He does like scissor leg, like diving heel hooks, flying submissions.
Did he do CJI or did he do ADCC?
No, no, I don't think he might have not have done
okay,
either.
Okay, gotcha. All right. Well, okay, but sorry.
No, he did CJI, I think.
Getting back to
whatever.
I think
so.
We
why should
to get
we care?
It.
Here goes why we should care. The UFC is going to be making a push in grappling. They are now signing grapplers, and they mm-hmm. made a recent announcement that they're going to be doing something like league-oriented.
Right.
Right?
I think Dana said they're trying to expand into all combat sports.
Yeah, so yeah, the UFC expanding into all combat sports, but the first one that they're really like jumping into outside of MMA mm-hmm. is going to be grappling. So get on now. It'd be like, imagine you, like, I'm assuming our audience is probably a little bit younger, but imagine, like, you know, you were there in 1996 and you started watching the UFC live during UFC 9.
Right.
Right? Here's your chance. Here's your chance to be like an early adopter and get in on it. So UFC Fight Pass this Thursday night.
Hold on. Should we discuss like who they acquired?
Yes, they acquired main event Mikey Musumeci.
Darth Rigatoni.
Darth Rigatoni. He'll be taking on Felipe Machado. To be honest with you, I don't know much about his opponent, but Mikey is a multiple-time world champion mm-hmm. at multiple weight classes in the gi. He also has a lot of really good wins. This will all be no-gi.
Yeah.
In submission grappling, recently submitting Gabriel Souza mm-hmm. by calf slicer, which avenged one of his earlier losses. Mm. One of the critiques that some people have about Mikey is that he doesn't compete in, like, the big events.
Right.
Right? Like, he hasn't done an ADCC
right.
or whatever. And people be like, oh, he's too small. Right? And there's some validity to that. The lightest weight class at ADCC is 66 kilo.
Mm-hmm.
But the guy that he just submitted took second at ADCC in 2022.
And also, he was signed to, you know,
to go against
Cade
Rotolo.
Yeah.
And in the IBJJF, he does the open weight. So he's going against right. guys of... So, you know, I really feel like I would like to have seen him partake in a mm-hmm. tournament such as that. But now maybe through the UFC Fight Pass, we'll get to see some of those matchups happen.
With that said, I'm very much rooting for Machado.
Yeah, you know, Mikey has in the past come off a little bit insufferable to me for my liking.
I think we can make it public knowledge that we don't like Mikey.
Yeah, I mean, like, I don't want to say I don't like him because I don't know that I don't like him. But, you know, there's been some, like, whining and things of that nature and like almost like unfounded like tantrums.
Listen, as someone who's a little further removed from it and like I'm probably never gonna meet the dude where he's like you might I used to really like him and yeah. then I started being like oh like
yeah we were like big on him
and then you were
when
like,
he was like first and one
right.
and stuff you were like all, we were all
I was
fired
super
up
about it dude, and then you were like dude this last opponent, he was like talking about all this stuff that the dude said. He didn't say any of it.
Yeah, yeah. Like, he was like, this guy what? Insults my family on every one of my Instagram posts talking about Gabriel Souza or whatever. And I think what it turned out being is Gabriel Souza liked, didn't even comment, right. liked his ex-girl, like one of his ex-girlfriend's Instagram posts.
Yeah, that's ridiculous.
Like, you know, like double click.
Yeah, Mikey's like, just making stuff up. Also, like, dude, the whole like Gordon thing with him being like, you
oh,
look like
yeah.
you're 40.
Yeah, but yeah, it was just like, and Gordon's like blind, says he's blindsided by, he's like, yeah, Mikey has always been like really nice to me. He was like training
yeah.
and stuff, and I've always been very complimentary of him.
Right, not that I don't think that, yeah. you know, Gordon is like a fun person to poke fun at because he takes things very seriously.
Yeah.
And I think he's like, I think if you're like Craig Jones and you're poking the bear and just trolling, then I think it's hilarious. But I don't think that's what Mikey was doing. I think he's just voicing his opinions.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, Mikey, sorry, if you hate everyone in jiu-jitsu who's doing steroids, you hate all of jiu-jitsu.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's the main event, but not the main event for me. The main event for me will be the co-main event, which is Jason Nolf, a former Penn State wrestler. Mm-hmm. Jason Nolf, a three-time NCAA champion, four-time finalist on a four-time champion Penn State team. That means all four of his years mm-hmm. on the team, they won the NCAA title. I will be taking on Hinato Canuto. Canuto, just an absolute legend of grappling. I do believe he was in the most recent CJI, but he's a human highlight reel of grappling. Has been in ADCC several times. Known for like flying submissions, cartwheel guard passes, things of that nature. So
exciting stuff.
A really exciting, entertaining style that's going to match up really well with Nolf. Nolf's probably one of his biggest accomplishments at the Olympic trials this past April. He took out Jordan Burroughs.
Oh, that's right.
That'd be his, in my opinion, his, I mean, it's got to be his biggest win.
Yeah.
Yeah, Nolf also took part in the CJI, losing first round to Ty Rotolo. But, you know, did, like, for white belt versus world-class black belt, did a lot. Did pretty good in there.
He did a lot better than I would have done as a white belt.
Yeah, certainly. yeah, so I'm really excited about that match.
That's cool.
Some other people on the card to take note of. Raquel Canuto, Hinata's wife, will be competing on this on the event as well. On the undercard, it looks like they're, because there's a separation. On the undercard, Ryan Aiken, he just recently came off of winning the PGF that we spoke about on the podcast. He'll be competing against Gabriel Almeida. Maggie Grandotti is on the card as well. Oh, Damian Anderson. Damian Anderson is a B-team product. Has recently went pro in MMA. I think he's like got to be like 3-4 or 5-0 as a pro already. After probably only fighting pro for like 18 months or so. Like, you know what I mean? And I believe his opponent, Sandre Silva, is Sandre Silva a UFC fighter, Max?
I couldn't find anything.
Okay, so maybe not. I was listening to the Simple Man podcast, which is, you know, Damian Anderson's podcast, in which he was saying that his match would be against a UFC fighter, so maybe something had happened there. Maybe that's not the case. We've also got Michael Pixley, who was the main event of the last UFC Fight Pass Invitational. He took a loss to Nicky Rod, but he is known for dethroning Nicholas Marigali at the ADCC's with a nice Uchimata into a Darce. The card opens up with Shelby Murphy, an AOJ student who I happen to follow on Instagram. She gives a lot of good tips about teaching kids jiu-jitsu. So,
right on.
There you go. So that's the UFC Fight Pass Invitational going down Thursday on UFC Fight Pass.
Very cool.
All right. I mean, shoot, that's everything I wanted to talk about.
Yeah.
You got anything else?
I think we covered the weekend of fights coming up.
Well, maybe something else that we could just like make a brief mention at. We got a contract signed.
We do.
Young Max Gerald will be fighting December 21st against Drew Landenfeld. This will be Max's farewell fight to the featherweight division. Mm-hmm. After this fight, he'll be dropping down to the bantamweight division where he rightfully belongs. Max, are you excited about this fight?
I am very excited about this
Very fight. Excited. What very can the people excited. Expect?
As long as he wants to keep it on the feet, it's going to be a fucking scrap on the feet.
All right, so Max going to be scrapping December 21st. Buy tickets, come to the fights. A proceed of all the tickets that you buy, Max is donating to the Listen to Your Coaches. No, I'm just kidding. All right. That's it for us. We'll catch you guys next time.